He's working to be great.
Let's all stand up. Let's all stand up. Let's give God some praise this morning. God is good to us.
Amen.
And we want to hear with our praise and our presence. Scripture says, praise the Lord.
Yes.
Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise Him in the heights above. Praise Him, all His angels.
Yes.
Praise Him, all His heavenly hosts.
Yes.
Praise Him, sun and moon. Praise Him, all you shining stars. Praise You in the highest heavens. Praise You, waters above the skies. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for He commanded and they were created. He set them in place forever and ever. He gave a decree that will never pass away. Praise the Lord from the earth, you great sea creatures in all ocean depths, lightning in the halls of heaven, snow and clouds, stormy winds who do the bidding of the Lord. You in the mountains, praise His name. Fruit trees and all cedars, wild animals, praise His name. Cattle of the earth, creatures and flying birds, praise the Lord. All kings and queens and princes, presidents and members of the Supreme Court, praise the Lord. Young men, old men, praise the Lord. Young ladies and older women, praise the Lord. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for His name alone is exalted. His splendor is above the earth and the heavens. He has raised up for His people a horn, and His name is Jesus. The praise of all saints and all the earth will bow down at that name. At the name of Jesus, every knee bows and every tongue confesses that Jesus is Lord. Let us sing. Lord, love me.
Thank you.
To declare how wonderful and how blessed we are to have you as our Creator. You brought us from a mighty long way. You brought us from trial and tribulation to many scars and better, more storms. Yet we are here on this day to declare how blessed we are. And to give you the praise and the credit for all that you've done for us. Bless this moment now in your heights, and those who are watching at home, those in different states who joined us, our partners, we give you, Lord, all the praise for them. Now, Lord, we pray that you will bless us today with the working of the Holy Spirit. For his sake we pray. Amen. While you remain standing, let us. Those in the north desk are there, the north desk ushers, please let them in. Amen. Let us share together as we recite the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the Maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He ascended into hell. The third day he arose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and stood on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the wicked and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. God bless you. So good to see you all in church this morning.
Amen.
Fire sounds good. I know that some people have a positive illness, I understand. Is that right? That's what I heard this morning. And for those of us who are here. Now, October the 6th, that's still on. Is that right, Madam Clerk?
Yes, yes.
October the 6th, we're going to have a reconsecration service for the sanctuary. And hopefully we'll have the cross hopefully in place by then. Is that still on schedule, Madam Clerk?
We have a lot going on.
No, the cross for the
cross.
The cross.
They were looking across the day and
had
to draw it myself.
Oh. That's going to give me a day. You know, it isn't often that a church gets a chance to reconsecrate a sanctuary.
Amen.
And we're going to do that on this Sunday. A consecration, we go back and read, for example, in Joshua chapter 3. It talked about them crossing over, them being the Israelites. They've been 40 years in the wilderness, 40 years in the desert. Now they're about to cross over the River Jordan and to take possession of the land that flowed with milk and honey. Remember that story? But before the crossing over, they have to reconsecrate themselves. That is, they come together before the crossing over, and they did several things. One, they asked God to bless them. Two, it was a pledge to rededicate their life and service to God. So what happened in the past? Well, that was the past. But now the future was ahead of them. Amen? So they said, Lord, bless us as we go forward. That's a different mindset. So on October the 6th, we invited the Charlotte Presbytery, and other churches to join us on that day. You've got to be here, but let's make sure that the Muir Heights community knows about it, Dr. Stacey. Want to get leadership here in Muir Heights, or those of you who even go to church. Let's invite the agnostics. I don't know who they are. Let's invite them all to come to this church on that day to have a rededication and a recommitment to our Lord Jesus Christ. On what date? October the 6th. Now, I know that's Holy Communion Sunday as well. So we're going to have a wonderful day in celebration for that moment. Those in the sanctuary, I see them coming in, let them in the sanctuary, please. Now, we have other announcements. Before we get there, I want to just say how happy Yvette and I are happy to be back with you. We had a wonderful vacation. This was, well, it wasn't restful, but it was wonderful. But we had a chance to join with some friends of ours as they were celebrating 50 years wedding anniversary. And so they invited some of their friends to join them on a cruise. So there were seven couples who joined them, eight couples who joined them in a cruise, and we went down, we flew to Rome and got on a ship there in Rome, and then we sailed down to Turkey, to Istanbul, and spent a couple day there, and went to Greece and to Italy, and came back on yesterday. But it was just a wonderful experience. We haven't had a chance to go to the Mediterranean before you go to heaven. Stop by. Stop by and say, hello, here. But very enriching, very informative. And we had been before to the Mediterranean, but to go with these friends was especially interesting. And also to go to Turkey, Istanbul, where I've always wanted to go, but never had a chance to go until this particular trip. But we'll tell you more about it privately if you ask, because we'll give you more information. But yesterday, we're in Barcelona, preparing to come back to Charlotte. Last Tuesday, I contracted a cold, and I guess I don't know where I was. Greece, I think. And it got into my head. Flying back yesterday, we had breakfast in Barcelona, got an 8-hour flight back to Miami. When you have a head cold and you get on a plane, the cabin pressure of the plane changes, and it aggravates a head cold. So I wasn't feeling well in Greece, and I'm feeling worse on the flight back. So last night, I was just miserable. So I pumped coffee, not because I'm sick. I'm not. I got a head cold. So I'm wheezing like crazy. Having had pneumonia twice in my life, when you start to wheeze, I get a little bit nervous because pneumonia is no joke. And so this morning at 5 o'clock, Yvette says, that's enough. I can't sleep. Get up. We're going to the hospital right now. So we're down in the emergency room this morning, and the doctor looked at me and they checked me out. I don't have COVID. Somebody say amen. I don't have COVID, and I don't have any serious illness, but I do have an extreme situation in my sinuses and in my ear. I can't hear you. I was saying to Beth, what are you saying? All day. So today in Sunday school, I know since Janora and Herman, they were teaching Sunday school, I couldn't hear hardly anything in church today. But I can barely hear you, and when you can't hear it, your speech sounds is off a little bit, so I'm not sure you can hear me. I guess you can. Now, when I call, I'm not spreading COVID, just so you know. But I don't feel the best at the moment, but I'm grateful to be here. But I'm taking antibiotics. The doctor said in a few days I should be back, able to hear my wife's voice again. She seemed nervous to me anyway. Well, isn't she? I hear you sometimes. But I want to, you know, we call it selective hearing. But we are fine, and we are so glad to be back in Charlotte. And thank you for your prayers during our time away. So with that, I have another announcement to make.
Good morning.
Good morning.
First, I want to welcome back our pastor.
Amen.
So happy. When I spoke to him last night, I heard what he was saying, And so I sent out a little note to the sessions and prayed that he'll be okay.
Yeah.
He's here. And he got back on the clothes. Thank you, sir. But Reverend Tuttle reminded you about our dedication service, our rededication, whatever we call it, because every time we call it something different. And also, that's another big singing. We have the crop walk going on, as John reminded me. And also, I understand there's a Christ reunion this year, is that correct? They will be here. And I need to talk to you about us eating together, breaking bread together. Also, we'll have a children's choir, so what will happen, isn't that right? I noticed Ted looked at me. I want to have some children sing on that. I mentioned that too, then we'll talk about that. I said it also, okay. Okay, I just want you. So it helps to put things out, announce the marriage before they even happen, because now you know we're expecting it. So thank you for my non announcements.
The date and time for the crop walk is when? The date and time?
The crop walk is from 1:30 to 2:30, that's registration, and the walk ends at 4 o'clock. It's at Memorial Stadium. So I guess after we eat, those who would like to walk, you can drive over and we can carpool to Memorial Stadium. I'm going to make an announcement about that next Sunday because I need people to register. I'm not able to register everyone, but I will need people to register. However, I'll make that announcement on next Sunday.
And what's the date, Charlotte?
October 6th. Same day as our dedication and everything else we got going on that Sunday.
That's why I get you. Good morning, church
family.
I have two announcements. Welcome back, Pastor. Prayers for your extreme situation. Did you hear me? Prayers for you.
Okay.
To the women, thank you. You showed up yesterday in Rocky River. Thank you. You showed up at Marks Creek in Hamlet, North Carolina. Thank you. And we thank you for all of the purses again and the toiletry. So we appreciate that. My next announcement is a welcome and a thank you to the Allison Porter family. Please stand. We're in reunion, and I'd like to welcome my cousins, family, and friends. Stand up, Jim. Glad to see all of you all. And, thank you for coming to church this morning. We'll celebrate and we will have an offering for the church. Thank you.
Good morning. Just have a quick announcement. We are having rehearsals on Wednesdays at 7 o'clock. We are looking for new members. We would love to have you. I'm so happy to see the children in the congregation. And hopefully we'll have a children's choir soon. But on Wednesdays, we have a lot of fun. And like Mr. Ted said, we need to put some flavor on it. So we need you all to come join us so we can add some more flavor to our choir. So when you join, I feel like we're a good choir, but once you join, we'll be an even better one. Thank you.
Happy Sunday, church family. Our leader of our health and wellness ministry has asked me to come up and share with you that we have a new blood pressure station that is located downstairs in our fellowship hall, sponsored by the American Heart Association. So if you, anytime that you would like to monitor your blood pressure, there are two blood pressure cuffs there. There are booklets for you to maintain that blood pressure and record that blood pressure. And there's also some literature there to provide for you to follow up with your doctor if that blood pressure is not where it needs to be. So that is a new addition to our fellowship hall, and please feel free to go down and check your blood pressure accordingly. The next announcement is just a huge thank you to each and every one of you who participated in our Greer Heights annual Labor Day reunion. I know I had fun, and hopefully if you attended, you had a lot of fun. So thank you. We have started planning for next year, which will be our 60th anniversary. So if you are interested in helping in any type of way, please see me. Have a wonderful day.
Good morning, church family. I'm Nadine, one of the trustees at the church. We got a couple of housekeeping items we need to go over. We're asking that when you come to sanctuary, do not bring colored drinks or anything like that. Nothing but water. We almost had an accident, didn't we, Jerry?
No.
So we're asking that you not bring any type of drinks or anything in the sanctuary. We like to keep it clean. We like to keep our fabric clean. Also, the other housekeeping, these doors, these closets behind me, I think they're room 12, 13, and 14. And also the choir room closet. Doesn't look like they've been cleaned out in a while. We have stuff in there that we have not used in years. One of these closets has a sleeping bag. I was told it was Reverend James when he was here, so you know that's been a while. So we would like to put up a sign-up sheet. If those closets is something that the ladies use, men use, technology, if you would sign up and schedule a clean-out date for those things, because we have more stuff we need to put in place. Also, the men's band pro should be wrapping up this week. It should be back in use come next Sunday. Thank you. Have a good day.
Thank you. Are there any other visitors with us this morning? Should we stand? Other visitors with us today, please stand. Let's acknowledge your presence. For those who are here for the family reunion, welcome once again to the Junior Heights Presbyterian Church. It's great to have you here with us. Let God pass the Lord's peace one to the other. May the Lord's peace be with you.
And also with you.
The ushers, please come forward. Father, we thank you now for these gifts that we're about to bring to you. Our tithes and our offerings, which you have already made possible in our lives. Everything we have, everything has come from you. None can brag or boast or say that they've earned it, that they deserve it, that they created it. But the truth is, the eternal truth is, you are the giver of all of our gifts. Now we have an opportunity to express our gratitude in part by these gifts, by giving to you our tithes and our offerings. And we pray that you'll bless these gifts to magnify and glorify this ministry of the Greater Heights Presbyterian Church. We thank you for the members and also our partners who are faithful in support of this ministry. We ask your blessings in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
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 Thank you.
Circumstance for which you are asking prayer.
George Jackson.
Uncle Ricky Hood.
Ella's family.
The state and family.
Darling
PNC committee, amen.
First,
Matthew's family. Matthew's family. John Rankin. John Rankin also included in our prayers.
Pray for Scott Ellis' family.
The family of Scott Ellis, amen. That service is tomorrow.
Maria Thurman.
Knox family.
The Knox family.
To keep the Haitian immigrants encouragement.
Amen.
The Pope family.
Was Otis Pope and John Dinkins.
Drive Presbyterian Church, the Grimes community. James Mills and Carol Lady.
Amen.
Danielle Mack and Brent Malone.
Amen.
Ashley today, Monica Wright.
Amen.
Smith Taylor's family.
Madison.
Amen.
Brenda Buffett.
Ricky Lockhart.
I support a plan, George, spend it.
Yes. Kamala Harris.
Kamala Harris, yes. And excuse me, we say that we need to really be mindful of what's going on in the nation. It's getting uglier and uglier and uglier. And the voices of division, the voices of hatred, the voices of racism and misogyny, they're getting louder and louder.
Yep.
And the more we preach love and peace and unity, they raise their voices all the more, saying we're not going to talk about love or unity or peace. We're in a bad place as a nation. We have forsaken all the commands of our Lord Jesus Christ for the sake of political expediency. We're in trouble. Let's be aware of the need to continue to pray. Let's not give up. And join their voices.
No.
And we're not going to become cynics or pessimists. We're going to remain optimistic on this. Let's trust God on this. And I'm not going to give up praying for love and peace and unity. That's what our Lord requires of us. We're not going to stop. We're not going to change our message. He hasn't changed his message. We're not going to change ours. So the more they speak, we're going to just be louder.
Amen.
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 Any other nice prayers? I want to thank you, God, for Reverend Greg Busby in my absence, and Reverend Gloria Bolton, who are speaking here at the church. The question is, where shall we go from our presence? Sometimes, Heavenly Father, we as your creatures think we can go somewhere where you are not. The scripture says if we go up to heaven, you're there. If we go down to the depths of the earth, you are there. But we also seek to go to other places. We think you reside only with those who are in powerful positions, those of a different hue. We make the mistake, Almighty God, of thinking that we run to certain places and stations in life. We'll be blessed by you in greater ways. If we seem to have our names on the marquee, bright neon signs, that's a good place to go. But we seek to go to the places where we can make lots of money and build huge portfolios. That's the place to go. Some of us have been deluded into thinking that if we live in a bigger house, we get bigger blessings. But we wear nicer clothes as a sign that we are being blessed with nicer blessings. We have deluded ourselves into thinking, Almighty God, that we don't have to pay as much attention to the commands of our Savior, Jesus Christ, your Son. That we can live by our way, our priorities, our agenda, and ignore your commands and your requirements and your purpose. How foolish we are as men and women and humanity to think that we can get along without you, that we don't need you in any quarter of our lives. Forgive us for our boldness, our chutzpah, to think that we can dare move in life without your authority, without your will. Today we humble ourselves before you. And we declare now more than ever, we need you, Heavenly Father, to come into our lives and into our families to protect our children and our children's children. This generation coming up after us, they don't know who you are. They don't know the power you bring and the purpose you are. So they've forsaken the need to bow down to you, to bow down to their Creator. Oh, how we worry about our children and our grandchildren.
Yes.
That generation is growing up without knowing who you are. We can't blame them totally. That's on us. We've not been as diligent as we could have been and should have been in teaching them about you. About your love, about your healing, about your peace. About your power, about your forgiveness, about your Son, Jesus Christ. We have not been diligent in telling them about you. We need forgiveness. Because that's on us. We've grown slack. We have not been deliberate. We have not been intentional to lift up that name that is above every other name. So they don't know. They don't know. And when somebody acts a fool, when they act crazy, we're going to point our finger at them. When it's been us, we've not held them up to the higher standard. Forgive us, Lord. as parents and grandparents. We put too much burden on them to do right when we have not acted right.
Yes.
Oh God, forgive us. And for all the names that were called out this morning, have mercy upon those names. Healing in those bodies. Bring strength to their loins and character to their thinking. Bless our nation that is so divided over politics. Can you believe? Not over sinful things, but over politics and money and race. White makes right. Oh my goodness. No greater lie ever told than that. We're not going to believe that. Our trust, Almighty God, is in you for this nation, for this day, for all the days coming. In Jesus' name, we trust you now and forever. Hallelujah. Amen.
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 Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you, choir. Pray for me this morning. I don't want to go into coughing spell. You want to get a coughing spell, you can't stop coughing. And you want to stop coughing, but it won't let you stop coughing. And I don't want to have that right now, sir. But I don't feel bad. Most of me doesn't feel bad. I want to say a word today about the one of us, a unique character. I say unique because he's the only one in the Bible, or two of them actually. But a word about Enoch, which I'll get to in just a moment. I cannot think things of another character in Scripture when there's so little said about him, when yet there's so much about him to be said. And his name is Enoch. Can you say it with me?
Enoch.
Enoch. Enoch. That's what it is. It's a great, great name. Enoch. It's a name that I hope you don't forget. E-N-O-C-H. Say it with me.
Enoch.
E-N-O-C-H. Genesis chapter 5. Beginning in verse 21. You find these words. But Enoch had lived 65 years. He became the father of Methuselah. And after he became the father of Methuselah, Enoch walked with God 300 years. And had other sons and daughters. Altogether, Enoch lived 365 years. Enoch walked with God. And then he was no more, because God took him away. When Methuselah had lived 187 years, he became the father of Lamech. And after he became the father of Lamech, Methuselah lived 782 years. Good Lord. And he had other sons and daughters. Altogether, Methuselah lived 969 years. And guess what? Then he died. When I was a boy growing up in Denver, they had a childhood riddle that maybe you learned when you were growing up in your part of town. Who was the oldest man to ever live and yet die before his father? You remember that riddle? You remember that riddle? You don't remember that. And of course, the answer is Methuselah. So, but the riddle is a crazy riddle, because how do you die before your father and still live to be the oldest man? That's a contradiction, isn't it?
Yes. Yeah.
And the reason is because Enoch never died. He did not die. Enoch lived 365 years, and the scripture says, it's in the verse, Enoch walked with God, and then he was no more. That is, he didn't exist on earth anymore. Why? Because scripture says, God took him away. Took him away without having to die. Did you know that story? Enoch lived 300, how many days, how many years? And did he die? Ah, that's right. Why? Because God took him. I want to just say a word about that today. My cousin, Darrell Hugh Harris, sent me a book about 2 years ago called Enoch.
This sermon is not based on that book, but certainly it raised a consciousness in my mind about the man, Enoch, because it's a great story. And I want to share with you this morning certain elements about this story that I hope you will not forget. Now, prior other way to church today, I called my good friend Jerry Cannon, whom I call often on Sunday morning. We had prayer together. I called several friends of mine who are also pastors, and we prayed for each other before we go to church, or as we're going to church. And one of my friends lives out in Wisconsin, and he's Ron Lawrence. I call him, and we have prayer. And Reverend Jerry Cannon, we have prayer on a regular basis. And have other friends out in South Carolina, and other friends around the country, and we call and we pray for each other, because pastors need prayer. And so we just do that as a routine. And it puts me and them, hopefully in the mind, we're going to go before the people and preach. So Jerry was sharing, my wife shared with him, how I didn't feel well this morning. And so Jerry said to her, not to me, but I heard the conversation, make sure you get the short sermon today. And I said, I will. And Jerry laughed. And how long is a short sermon? And so that's in about 15 minutes. You're laughing. Okay. I knew you were going to laugh. Well, it might be 15 minutes. We'll see. But I want to say a word about the topic, walking with God. Chilling with the thing. Now, as you say that, think of yourself and say it again. Think of yourself and then say the words. Now put your name before you say the phrase and then say it again. Reggie Tuttle. Walking with God. There's power just in saying that. Yes. Can you imagine Reggie Tuttle walking with God? That God gives me permission to walk with Him?
Yes.
And better yet, God has blessed me to walk with Him.
Amen.
So here in this sermon today, I want to say a word, Genesis chapter 5. Verses 21 through 25. And it doesn't say an awful lot about Enoch, except these words. And they're powerful words. Enoch walked with God. Let's say a word. Who was Enoch? The Bible tells us that he was the son of Jared, what it says in Genesis chapter 5, verse 18. But he was also the father of Methuselah. We just mentioned a moment ago, 969 years. But then I noticed something about Methuselah. After all those years of living, Scripture says nothing more about him. It just simply says he died. They didn't do anything great, apparently. Not noteworthy anyway. It just says he lived almost 1,000 years and then he died. I like listening to jazz. I know some of you do as well. So sometimes listen to jazz. And yesterday I was listening to Ella Fitzgerald and Louis Armstrong. They were two great musicians. They don't live 900 years. But they left their mark. And I think of anything of note about your life and mine, however long you live, you should leave a mark. Something that says you were here.
Yeah.
That somewhere in life you touched somebody's life. Maybe you helped somebody over a hurdle. And you provided a bridge for somebody to cross from here to there. Your life should be more than just simply a dash between your birthday and death day. You follow me?
Yeah.
It shouldn't matter. So here in these words, it says, Enoch walked with God. And I can really sit down now and see that whole sermon. And that's how you should live life, walking with God.
Yes.
But this brief record of his life, it summarizes something about who the man was, who Enoch was. The words walk with God denotes a life of devotion. Enoch was devoted to God. He was in communion with God. The word says that he was not, meaning he did not die. As a matter of fact, when we read Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5 is a verse that you, chapter 11, verse 5, it says, by faith Enoch was translated that he should not see death.
Yes.
He was not found because God had translated him, and therefore he never had to see the rigors and the torment of dying. He lived by walking with God. Enoch was a man who walked with God, and this notion of walking with God suggests something else. He shares certain prominent notions about what it means to walk with God. I want to share with us today four elements of walking, what it means to walk with God. Take out your pencil and pad if you want to. And I want to share with us these four elements of what it means to walk with God. One, to walk with God means you are a companion with God. That's right, companion. That is, you walk in agreement. When Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, he said, what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? None, of course. For we are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell with them, and they will walk in them, and I will be their God, and they will be my people. And so the agnostic, that is the person who said, I don't know if they're really God or not. He said, where is God? But for the Christian and for Enoch, that would never be the question, where is God? Because where I am, there is God. And where God is, I'm with him. There's a quiet companionship that walks with when you walk with God. A song came out so many years ago that I used to love hearing in our choir singing. I used to sing it myself. And the words and the lyrics says, I miss my time with you, our moments together. Remember that song? Those quiet moments together. Do you spend time with God? Do you spend time with God in scripture? Do you spend time with God in the morning? One of the great joys I have in my own personal life is every morning I like getting up and going out for a walk and going to the gym. But I pause during that time and I just open myself up to listening.
Yeah.
I don't want to say a word. I want to just listen. Lord, what are you saying to me now? What are you putting into me? What are you pouring into me? Sometimes when we go to God, we talk too much.
Yeah.
We go down in prayer and we're babbling and talking. And we're talking to God that knows what's going on in our lives. We're telling about our marriages in trouble, our illnesses and our diseases, and our grief and our dying and problems in the streets. It's if God is ignorant of all these things. Don't you know by now that God knows everything about everything? So why do we pray in such a way to suggest, God, have you heard? Or God, did you know? That's the mystery of presentation of who you think God is. Of course God knows. Of course he's heard. He's heard everything, even your silent thoughts. Go back one of these days and read Psalm 139. Mm. God knows everything about you, even before you know about you. He knows your words before you speak them, your actions before you commit them. He knows you when you're being formed in that secret place. He knew you before you were born. Mm. So of course God knows. So then why do you pray? Ah. The question, why do I pray? Ah. One, because I'm praying to the only one in the universe who understands everything about everything.
Yeah.
Number one. Number two, I'm praying to the only one who has the power and the authority to do anything about it.
Amen.
But number three, I'm praying because I trust him.
Amen.
Don't you see? I'm not praying to bring God news. I'm praying because he has authority. When you read scripture, when you read according to scripture, in fact, the Old and New Testament talks about when you pray, you're acknowledging your trust in God.
Yes.
That's what you're doing, and not in man. But companionship means something else. A friend loves at all times. When you read Proverbs chapter 17, verse 17, it talks about a friend. And see, and God is a companion who is near at all times. He makes his abiding with us something that is never ending.
Yeah.
Yes. I've had a few friends in my life, and I'm sure you have too. Most of us don't have many friends, and if you have many friends, something wrong with you. Oh, you missed that, didn't you? You got a lot of friends. Something is wrong with you. Because friendship is like a pearl.
Yes.
A friend is like a diamond. You don't have a lot of diamonds dripping all over you, pearls pouring all over you. You don't want to be like with MC Hammer. You can't touch this. He was a one-hit wonder. And he made millions of dollars. And he had all those sycophants hanging all around him, supporting his cousins and his nieces and his nephews and everybody else. And in 3 years, he was bankrupt. They were leeches. So people who call themselves friends, it's okay with that. Whatever they call themselves, that's okay with what they call themselves. But you gotta be careful how you label them. Everybody cannot be, by definition, a friend in your life.
Yeah, right. Amen.
Confucius put it this way. The question put to him, one of the students said, Master Confucius, should a man be loved by everybody? And Confucius said, oh no. A man should not be loved and respected by everybody. He should be loved and respected by those who themselves are loved and respected.
Yes, yes.
But if a thief loves you, or if a murderer loves you, something is wrong. Or to put it in common vernacular, if the Proud Boys love you, and the Oath Keepers love you, and the KKK loves you, something is wrong with that picture. I don't want to be endorsed by the Oath Keepers, by the Proud Boys, by the KKK. Something is wrong if everybody loves you. You can't have good people on both sides. You got to choose your friends wisely. And hopefully, they're choosing you wisely. Because that's the other side of the coin. I've got to be careful whom I let get close to me. And if you're smart, you'll be careful who you let get close to you. But the scripture says, Enoch walked with God. Close. And see, a friend loves at all times. I've had a few friends in my lifetime, so grateful for them. Because I know I can trust my friends. I can trust them. I don't mean that I'm perfect. But even when a friend tells me when I'm wrong, we can get in a loving way. That's what a friend does. But a companion is a friend is somebody who walks with you faithfully for all your entire life. A friend is not someone who loves you seasonally. Because the sun is shining and it's a warm day. But let a cold day come. Let money run out of your pocket. And then see how close of a friend they are. So, a friend is a companion. Number two. I'm going to get through this, not in 15 minutes, Sister Jane, but I'm going to make it 17. When you walk with God, certain demands are placed upon you. Enoch walked with God. Walking with God demands, listen to this please, entire surrender. You can't walk with God and expect to tell him what to do. You can't walk with God and say, Lord, I want you to conform to my will. No, that isn't when you walk with God. When you walk with God, you have to surrender to his will. That's the only way you can continue the journey. And if you want to get out of step with God, try to live like your way. And the moment you try to live like your way, you're out of step. You can't walk with God and have your own agenda, your own way, of looking at life. No. You have to walk in a way that you put him first and you acknowledge him. That's how you can stay in step with him. And so, you see, walking with God demands surrender to God's will. That's what it does. And Paul indicated this when he wrote, he says, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Jesus Christ, my Lord. He says, you know, to say, I consider them treacherous and tentative when it comes to my own things that I love. I don't love things in this world more than I love God. Also, walking with God demands unbroken fellowship. In case you ever forgot, the scripture says, we praise God and praise Jesus Christ. That's not what Jesus said about himself. Jesus never said, I want you to praise me. That's not, Jesus never said those words. He says, I want you to follow me. Pick up your cross daily and what? Follow me. But it is in the following of him that you're giving the praise. But if you're praising him with your lips only and not following him in your deeds and your actions, you're not walking in step with God. Walking with God also demands continual progress. When you walk with God, you're always going forward. You're never going backwards. And I say to this church all the time, I know that your High Presbyterian Church is a great church. It's a part of a congregation. But I say to you today, once again, on this 15th day of September, you're not going to go forward in this life, in this church, by looking backwards. You've got to look forward. Our knowledge of God must continually be growing, because the chariot wheels of life never stand still. Each day is a new journey.
Yes.
We have not passed this way before. We journey forward toward a new country to build a new Greer Heights Presbyterian Church. We are grateful for our past, grateful for those who served in this congregation, those whom God has already called unto glory. Now they're serving God for all eternity. But what are we doing now for our future and for the future of the gospel of Jesus Christ in the Greer Heights community?
Hallelujah.
If we have our eyes looking only backwards, you cannot walk in step with God, because God is moving on.
Amen.
You're not standing here, and is not looking back. But also, when you walk with God, it demands some suffering. That's what it does. Those who walk with God suffer the criticism and sometimes even the hatred of others.
Yes.
And that's why those of us in Christ are not always welcomed in the circles of the world. I can't tell you over the years how many times I've gone into a situation, having a good time, and I show up. All of a sudden, shh, shh, shh. Pastor, you're not going to do that. You ain't going to. Put that away. If I didn't see it already. And my ears are not virgin. I've heard every square word in the book. But your friends will leave you if you stay faithful to Jesus Christ. You won't be welcomed in every circle, but you're not supposed to be welcome. I don't want to be part of the den of thieves. I will not participate in the conversation with men and talking about other women as if it's not holy. Why would I want to keep company with such men? No, let me get another set of people who I regard as my friends, whom I can laugh with and joke with and have a good time without denigrating women or violating marriage. Don't you see? When you walk with God, there are certain things that are going to be required of you, and among them, to suffer sometimes the abuse and criticism of others. Number three. There's a certain manner of walking with God. Walking with God requires faith. I cannot tell you the number of times I personally, and maybe you too, have been driven to tears because I didn't understand what God was doing in my life or around me.
Yes.
People I loved and cherished were hurting, dying. Going through hardships one after the other, and I couldn't do anything about it. Lord, what are you doing here? What's this all about, Lord? We receive Christ through faith, Paul said. We are children of God by faith in Jesus Christ. And by faith, for by grace, we are saved through faith. and not of ourselves. It is a gift of God and not of our own works, lest any man should boast. We walk, you see, by faith in happiness. We walk by faith in sorrow. We walk by faith in turmoil. We walk by faith in death.
Yes.
We walk by faith even in impossible situations.
Yes.
Not now. I'm blessed with a whole lot of material things. But there have been times in my life, and Yvette knows this, I've been not poor, but poor. Man, you don't understand this. But I couldn't afford the R. Y'all catch me wrong. I mean, literally, I didn't have a dime on my pocket, not anything. And he said, Lord, what's going on here? You have to learn, you see, to walk by faith through the turmoil, and walk by faith through your health uncertainties. You're diagnosed with cancer, or you're diagnosed with, you have a stroke, and you don't walk like you used to walk. You have dementia, you don't think. I was on the ship the other day, I was talking to one of our companions, husbands had dementia. And he didn't function like he used to before he had dementia. And the thing about dementia is, you know you got it.
Amen.
You know you have certain mental deficiencies. You know your cognitive skills are not what they were before you had dementia.
Yeah.
You get caught up and say, why am I can't say certain words. I don't remember how to do certain things.
Yeah.
I used to know how to tie my shoe, but now I can't tie my shoe. Yeah. And you know you can't tie your shoe.
Yes.
You see the world come before you, so do you give up your walk then? No. Walking with God means walking by faith.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yes.
It's a walk that if you know everything,
yeah,
you're not walking with God.
Yeah.
It's a walk where you, if you have control of everything about your life, you're not walking with God.
Mm-hmm.
Walking with God means there's so much in life that you cannot control.
Amen.
But you keep trusting Him anyway.
Yes.
That's walking with God.
Yes.
When your marriage is in trouble and you don't know how to turn, what to do, you keep trusting anyway. That's walking with God.
Oh, yeah.
Walking with God means facing uncertainty as if it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
I don't know what tomorrow's going to bring. Doesn't matter. I don't know if God can heal my body. It doesn't matter.
Yes.
I don't know if God can restore my cognitive skills or not. It doesn't matter. I don't know if my son will ever love me again. It doesn't matter.
Yes.
Your walk has to be consistent in season and out of season.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. That's how you know. Not because you understand everything. You may understand nothing about the walk. Walk anyway. In the storm, in the darkness, keep walking.
Yeah.
In the dark tunnel, keep on walking with God.
Yeah.
That's how you do it.
Oh, yeah.
Walking with God means walking in truth.
Yeah.
That's what it means. When Jesus said in John 14, I am the way, the truth, and the life, he's talking about Enoch and maybe hopefully about me too. And you. I dare not put my hope and faith in money and politics and government, teachers, and I dare not put my trust in my own mama, and I love her. I love her dearly. She's gone on the glory now. But as much as I love my own mama, and she knows this, I trust God more.
Oh, yeah. Yes.
you trust him first.
Yes.
Well, also it's a spiritual walk. That's what it says. It's a spiritual walk. Yeah. Walk by the Spirit and not with glory with glory seeking flesh. Walk by, it's a spiritual thing. And lastly, I want to say this, and I'm going to stop. I know I'm literally on 15 minutes. I'm sorry for that. But I got to get my last point in. Walking with God is a privilege.
Oh, yeah.
That's what I want to say. Walking with God has been and is and shall always be a privilege. The greatest of all feelings is the joy of walking with God on the highway of life, knowing that you are forgiven and cleansed of all sin. To know that no sin, say no sin, has the power to condemn you to hell or keep you out of heaven. Oh, what a privilege that is to know that I'm walking with the King.
Oh, yeah. Yes.
It's a privilege. He allows me to walk with him. And I'm honored to know he's walking with me. That I saw over there in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5, where Jesus said about himself regarding us, he says, I will never leave you or forsake you.
Oh, yeah.
I don't care about your cancer. I don't care about the storms in life. I don't care about your grief. I don't care about your heart attack. I don't care about anything in life. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Enoch understood that. Enoch understood that. And so it's a very short description of his life. He lived 365 years. 300 years after he gave birth to Methuselah. He was 65 years old when he gave birth to Methuselah. And lived another 300 years after that. And it says about his journey. It says, Enoch walked with God. I must confess, I have not walked with God the way Enoch did. I have too much dirt in my life, too many sins in my life, too much arrogance perhaps in my life. But I'm trying though.
Oh, yeah.
Every day I try to walk with God.
Yeah.
And I'm grateful that he allows me.
Yeah.
If there's a man and woman here today who does not have a church home, I invite you today to come and give your life to the Lord. As we stand and as we sing, Lord, I want to be a Christian. In my heart. In my heart. The door stands open. Let us stand and sing this wonderful song. I want to be more loving. I want to be more holy. In my heart. I'm on the battlefield. I'm on the battlefield. one from my Lord. It's a great, great song. Let's sing it. Ready? Savior Jesus Christ, the communion of the Holy Spirit rests with each and every one of us. Now, henceforth and forevermore, and let the church say,
amen. I'm going to go to the next one.